A reading from the 11th chapter of Numbers. The rabble among them had a strong craving, and the Israelites also wept again and said, "If only we had meat to eat. We remember the fish we used to eat in Egypt for nothing, the cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. But now our strength is dried up, and there is nothing at all but this manna to look at." Now the manna was like coriander seed, and its color was like the color of gum resin. The people went around and gathered it, ground it in mills or beat it in mortars, and then boiled it in pots and made cakes of it. And the taste of it was like the taste of cakes baked with oil. When the dew fell on the camp in the night, the manna would fall with it. Moses heard the people weeping throughout their families, all at the entrances of their tent. Then the Lord became very angry, and Moses was displeased. So Moses said to the Lord, "Why have you treated your servant so badly? Why have I not found favor in your sight that you lay the burden of all this people on me? Did I conceive all this people? Did I give birth to them that you should say to me, 'Carry them in your bosom, as a nurse carries a suckling child,' to the land that you promised on oath to their ancestors? Where am I to get meat to give to all this people? For they have come weeping to me and say, 'Give us meat to eat.' I am not able to carry all this people alone, for they are too heavy for me. If this is the way you're going to treat me, put me to death at once. If I have found favor in your sight, and do not let me see my misery." So the Lord said to Moses, "Gather for me 70 of the elders of Israel, whom you know to be the elders of the people and officers over them. Bring them to the tent of meeting, and have them take their place there with you." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Just kill me now. Like a parent driving cross country in a station wagon full of fighting and complaining children, Moses has reached his breaking point and tells God, "Just kill me now." As George Costanza would say, the kids were angry that day, my friends, like an old man sending back soup in a deli. This wasn't the first time that they had complained, and nor would it be the last. In our Old Testament reading today, we are witness to one of the many times that the Israelites complain about their well-being in their desert journey to the promised land. Moses has already heard the equivalent of, "I'm too hot, Johnny's touching me, I know he just stopped, but I've got to pee." Now it's time to complain that the food isn't what they ordered. The Israelites are tired of eating the manna, this miracle food that rains down from heaven each night to fill their bellies. But they've decided that they don't want rice cakes for a snack today. They want beef jerky. The riffraff, the troublemakers in the back seat, have finally gotten to Moses. He is fed up, and he lowers himself to their standards. If you're a parent or even ever a babysitter, you know it happens. Moses stopped acting like the mature one, and he too started to complain. Don't judge. We have all been there. And if you haven't, then I know for a fact that you haven't traveled cross country with a car full of kids. This trip through the desert, on the way to Wally World, the promised land, was more than Moses had signed up for. Like a bad dream, the number of kids in the back seat seemed to be multiplying too fast to count. His responsibilities were becoming too much for him to bear on his own. And so, like he's threatened so many times before, Moses pulls the car over to the side of the road. Now Moses is a good guy, so instead of taking each one of them out and scolding them individually, he figures that he will just leave them all behind as a whole and walk away. He figures that if God gave them to him, then God can have them back. So Moses opens the driver's door, steps out, slams it shut, but before he takes his first step away, God intercedes by putting it into Moses' heart to turn to God in prayer. You see, in the past, it had been Moses who always called God down from getting angry at the Israelites. But this time, the roles are reversed. This time, God calms down Moses. And boy, it took some convincing. In an act of graceful understanding that we may struggle to understand, God patiently listens to Moses' complaint. God listens to Moses' frustrations, and trust me, Moses really lets God have it this time. But God takes the butt chewing like a pro. I think we've all been able to relate to Moses' frustrations sometime in our lives. And like Moses, we probably all have moments that we wish we could take back. Moments in which our fury got the best of us. Each one of us, too, has reached a breaking point, a time when the weight of the world was just too much to bear. Moses' burden of leading the Israelites had finally become too much for Moses to bear on his own, so he turned to God in complaint for help. And God responded to Moses by creating an environment in which the burden was shared. True to God's form, Moses didn't just get one co-pilot for the passenger seat to hand out snacks and change the radio stations as the kids requested. No, God gave him 70 people to share the burden. God must have really known just how ticked Moses was. Now, not all of us have kids to drive us crazy on road trips, but we all have responsibilities and burdens to bear in life. The good news for all of us is that, like Moses, we too don't have to bear the weight of the world on our own. Like Moses, God has given us a community we can turn to share the burden. We know it as the church, this amazing, grace-filled place that binds us together, intertwining us with God's self through the Holy Spirit. Sure, we can try and take it all on alone like Moses did, but like in Moses' situation, the riffraff kids in the backseat will eventually become overburdened. Of course, we can try and be the strong leader, the hero that decides that taking a car of kids across country alone is a good idea. But like the station wagon, our tires will shrug under the weight. The problem that arises with the superhero mentality is that even though we know we can't handle it on our own, we still don't let anybody else in to help bear the burden. For some reason, we struggle to believe that we don't have to be the hero, that we already have a hero. But the good news is that when our ego finally betrays us and we are ready to walk away from it all, our real hero, Jesus Christ, will be there to pick up the pieces and bring us into the fold in which we bear the weight of the world together. Like the hippies taught us, it takes a village to raise a child. I say, if you really want to take all of the neighborhood kids to Wally World on your own, you're crazy. Of course you can try. But when they finally get to you and you stop the car, ready to walk away and just give them back to God, take a moment and pray. And then follow God to the place where we live in community together, sharing in each other's burdens, offering help wherever we can, following Christ's example of sacrifice. Come to church. That's the reason why we're all here, to share each other's burdens like Christ has done for us. Even though we have our own crosses to bear, like Moses driving those complaining kids across the desert for 40 years, God doesn't call us to bear the weight on our own. God has given us this whole church in which we can find the help and comfort of God that we all so desperately need. This is what the community we call the church is all about. We don't have to do it on our own. We can count on each other to share the burden. Let's find joy in the trip together, because that is what God wants. Amen.